Hey everybody, welcome to the Abroaders Travel Podcast, your weekly meetup with thousands of entrepreneurs, hustlers, creators, nomads, ninjas, wanderers, and world changers, all seeking to build the skills and connections to live a life without borders. If you want to learn more about what we do or download our entire podcast archive, check out the website, abroaders.com. Happy Wednesday morning, and welcome to another episode of the Abroaders Travel Podcast. I'm Erik Paquette, here with AJ Dunn, and today we are going to talk about award travel redemption. You can find the episode at abroaders.com/redemption. We did have a couple of false starts getting today's episode recorded. My local neighborhood here in Florianopolis is going to be performing an ensayo de samba for carnival, which essentially means that at any given moment, 50 people might show up outside my house and start practicing on a variety of drums, handmade percussion instruments, and assorted noisemakers. So hopefully we can get through this. We got a lot of awesome stuff to cover. And if these guys have another practice session, I'm going to try and cruise over there and get a microphone in the middle so you guys can hear the awesome racket that these dudes cook up, because it's pretty cool.
That's awesome. Speaking of a little bit of noise, thanks guys for downloading a bunch of episodes and leaving us awesome reviews and feedback. The Abroaders Podcast is now on the front page of iTunes and popping up for millions of people looking for awesome travel content.
Yeah, thanks everybody for spreading the word. This week we were featured on the Tropical NBA podcast, which has a following of probably pretty close to six figures. So we are really seeing a huge boost from that. Also from everybody who's out there telling their friends, their family. And if you haven't done so yet, hop over to iTunes, leave us a five-star review. This week, we've got more new reviews than we can possibly read over the air, but we did pick out a couple of favorites.
Yeah, so Harry Duran says, Erik and AJ bring fresh content on travel hacking every week. This is really great info, and we're only four episodes in. Highly recommended if this subject interests you. Bonus, they have an eclectic taste in music, as you'd expect from world travelers. By the way, I'm excited for our Jam of the Week coming up on this episode.
So am I. Yeah, Harry's also a fellow entrepreneur in the Dynamite Circle, and I just discovered his Know Your DJ iPhone app, which is a really cool application if you're into electronic music. It's something that's kind of new for me, so I've been just discovering new artists left and right, so check that out as well. Another review, Sean Markey says, wow, does this show bring it, in all caps. Packed with tips on how to get the most out of your travel. I love the episode about hacking credit cards to take advantage of the miles and points they award and using it for ridiculously awesome vacations.
That's right.
Thanks a lot, Sean. I hope you're listening today, because we're going to lay down the foundations to take those miles you're earning and actually book those awesome vacations. Now, before we dive in, one quick product announcement. Our good friend Vlad just launched on Kickstarter the coolest travel wallet that I've ever seen. He was walking around at the conference in Bangkok last fall with a prototype, and this thing is the real deal. I just bought one on Kickstarter. They're offering some discounts for early birds, so if you're into that kind of thing, check it out. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, man, it really is awesome. As I was going away party in Ho Chi Minh City, and he whipped that thing out, and it's like, man, I need this. So we'll toss it into the show notes. If you don't know about Kickstarter, by the way, get a look. It is an awesome launch pad for great ideas from entrepreneurs around the world. All right, so now this is the fun part of travel hacking. We're getting into the redemption. If you do it right, you can get tens of thousands of dollars in free travel each year. Booking with points can be confusing, especially for beginners, so we created this overview to help you hack your way into incredible travels.
When planning a redemption, start by considering what points you have. In episode 4, we covered the three types of points banks are giving away: transferable, airline-specific, and fixed value. To keep things simple, we're going to start by focusing on the airline-specific points. And there are a couple of rules that you should generally keep in mind when thinking about points and frequent flyer programs. The type of points you have determine what frequent flyer program you use to book your flight. If you have American Advantage miles, you have to book according to the rules of the Advantage program run by American Airlines.
Yeah, so you can think of airline-specific points as a type of currency that cannot be exchanged. You can't move United miles to American miles or any other program without, you know, taking them in the shorts. So, you know, if you have euros, you got to spend them in the eurozone. If you have U.S. dollars, you got to spend them in the United States.
In general, the points you redeem need to be in the same frequent flyer account. So, in other words, if AJ has 22,000 American miles in his account and I have 28,000 in my account, we can't combine the two balances and redeem for two awards at 25,000 each. sharing and buying miles can get really expensive. Either the broker or the airline themselves are taking a huge cut and they undermine the value of your points. So unless there's like a special promotion where they're offering bonus miles for sharing or buying, you probably want to stay away from that and just try and plan ahead so that you end up with enough miles in one account to book the trip you want.
Yeah, you'll want to know your point balances before you start considering booking your booking options, that is. There's a really awesome website called awardwallet.com, and that tracks most of your accounts for you, which is really handy once you get to diversifying miles with a bunch of different airlines and you have increased volume of points. Now, there are a couple airlines, they're being selfish, they're being greedy, and they're preventing Award Wallet from updating your balance, so you're going to have to manually check certain accounts of yours,
We're looking at you, American Airlines.
Yeah, it is what it is.
Yep. Definitely check out the tool, though. As you build up and diversify, you're going to want to have those balances at your fingertips. It's going to make it a lot easier to book things yourself, or if you're checking out a booking service, working with us, we're going to want to just have all the points in one place, so get a look at that. The frequent flyer program sets the core rules about how you can redeem your points. And the rules really break down into three main categories that we're going to cover today. Number one is award charts and pricing. Basically, these are the rules that determine how much it's going to cost you to go from point A to point B. Number two is the booking and routing rules. Are you allowed to book a one-way flight from A to B without being charged for the round trip? Can you stop in Tahiti for 2 weeks on the way from A to B? Can you change your flights or the destination on the day of your trip, before your trip, once you've started? Those are the kind of things we're going to look for.
Yeah, so the third is partners and alliances. Most frequent flyer programs are directly related to an airline, but that absolutely does not mean you need to fly in that airline. For example, Mileage Plus is a frequent flyer program for United Airlines. We can fly on any plane owned by them. So, for example, Thai Airways, Lufthansa, and dozens of others.
Yep, so that's exactly right. Your partner airlines are going to expand your options. We'll get into that later in the show. Now, if you're starting to feel like you're ready to pull your hair out, hang in there with us. Frequent flyer program rules are intentionally confusing. They want you to get frustrated and cash out your points for a blender or some other low-value crap. The more complex the rules, the bigger the opportunities, and we're going to be here for you guys every step of the way. Today, we're just covering the basics, but each of these three categories is going to have its own dedicated podcast episode to get into all the detail and answer your questions. So submit those on the AUA page, broaders.com/AUA.
Yep. So a program's award chart is simply a list of prices and miles. It tells you how many points or miles you need to book the flights you want. Sometimes airlines have multiple award charts. For example, United Airlines just released a new chart on February 1st that's got one list of prices if you want to fly by planes owned by United, and a different list of prices if you want to travel on the Star Alliance partner airlines like Thai, Lufthansa, or Air Canada.
There are three basic structures for award pricing. Fixed value pricing means that each point is worth a certain amount of money towards a flight. So in this system, award prices fluctuate exactly in sync with the cost of actually buying a ticket with cash. In other words, a $500 flight costs twice as many points as a $250 flight.
Zone-based award charts divide the world into regions and set fixed price for flying from one region to another. For example, one zone might be called North America. Let's say North America includes New York, Chicago, Miami.
All right, so the other zone could be South America 1 and include Buenos Aires, Argentina, and Sao Paulo, Brazil. In this system, it would be the same price to fly from New York City to Sao Paulo as it would be to fly from Chicago to Buenos Aires, which is actually quite a bit further.
Yeah, so distance-based award charts set a price based on the real-life number of miles between two airports. So in frequent flyer programs, you hear about tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of miles. We're talking about the actual miles, 5,280 feet in a mile. And so distance charts provide some huge opportunities if you can find cities right inside the edge of the range. Boston to Dublin, for example, is 2,993 miles. JFK in New York to Dublin is 3,179 miles. You get where we're going here.
Yeah, so the British Airways chart, by the way, great stat there on that mileage distance. In the British Airways award chart, there's a price cutoff right at 3,000 miles. So Boston to Dublin costs 25,000 miles round trip in coach or 50,000 miles round trip in business class. It's one of the best deals available to Europe from the United States. On the other hand, if you fly from New York instead of Boston, you're going to end up paying 40,000 miles in coach or 80 in business class. So you're seeing a huge increase, and those cities are really close to each other. So it makes a difference if you fly inside the boundary of the award chart.
Yeah, so in addition to the three pricing structures, most programs have discounted or saver awards that are available when the demand is low. During high season or when a flight's nearly full, a higher-priced standard award might be the only option.
We'll be back to talk lots of specifics about the award charts and pricing next week, including how to deal with those nasty fuel surcharges that you can't pay with miles. So stay tuned for that. Right now, we're going to move on and cover some basic info about booking and routing rules.
Yeah, so these are the rules that determine what your itinerary is going to look like. And there's some huge opportunities to squeeze more value out of your miles if you understand a couple options.
First, let's do some definitions. When we say booking rules, we're talking about things like, do you have to pay a fee to book a flight that's only a few days away?
Yeah, what does it cost to change your destination from, say, Paris to Barcelona?
What does it cost to change your date of travel, for example, if you want to leave Saturday instead of on Friday?
Can you make changes to your itinerary after travel has started?
Will an airline hold your reservation while you confirm the other parts of your trip? So, for example, if you want to fly to Europe in less than 3 weeks, United or American Airlines are going to charge you an extra $75 close-in booking fee. British Airways, on the other hand, doesn't charge an extra penny, even if you want to fly out later this afternoon.
Yeah, American would charge you $150 to change your destination from Paris to Barcelona, but it would be free to change the date from Saturday to Friday.
United will let you change your itinerary even if you've already taken your first flight, while Delta won't even let you make changes 3 days before your trip starts.
Yeah, so if you think you might need to change your itinerary, make sure to check with the airline to see what that will cost or to see if it's even possible.
All right, so the last type of booking rules tend to be the most problematic. Some airlines will not let you book itineraries with a mixed class of service. So for example, if you fly from Chicago to New York to Berlin, you might not be able to fly coach on the first leg and business class or first class on the overwater segment to Europe.
Some airlines won't let you mix partner airlines on the same itinerary or charge a bunch of miles if you do. For example, if you flew United from Chicago to New York to Berlin in first class, you'd pay 80,000 miles if all your flights were on a United plane. You'd pay 110,000 miles if you used their partner, Lufthansa, for the New York to Berlin segment.
Finally, some of these airlines charge nasty fuel surcharges on top of the miles. A flight that should be free or very close to it might cost you up to $1,000 plus the frequent flyer miles if you use the wrong partners. The point here, folks, is not to memorize any of this stuff. We're hustling really hard to put together the resources on the Abroaders website so you can just check and make sure. The key takeaway here is that you need to realize that this stuff varies tremendously from program to program. And it can also change without warning. So you need to just take the time to go to school on the program rules with the points you have and make sure that you're aware of anything that could come into play.
Yeah, the majority of people end up paying much more than necessary because they didn't realize a little booking rule screwed up the award pricing. If you're new to this stuff, you should really consider getting an expert involved, even if it's just to look over what you're planning and make sure that you can do, you know, have a better itinerary for the same amount of miles.
Yeah, exactly. To be totally honest, I mean, these airline systems that book it, sometimes they have computer systems price the awards and they screw up. It's not perfect. Sometimes, even worse, they allow the agents to price the awards, and one agent might be charging you an extra 50 or 70% based on what they think the rules are. And if you know better, you can explain that they're pricing it wrong. So anyways, we'll get some resources out there for that. I'd like to move on here for some routing rules. First, to define, these are things like, can you book a one-way ticket for half the price of a round trip?
Are you allowed to stop on the way to your final destination without paying extra?
If you do stop, how far are you allowed to deviate outside the direct path from your origin to your destination?
Is it possible to fly into one city and home from a different one?
Okay, so let's start with the one-way awards. These are critical to adding extra flexibility in your travel. The industry standard is to charge mileage based on a round trip. So even if you only want to go from the U.S. to Europe, most frequent flyer programs will make you pay for the return trip anyways.
A few notable exceptions are British Airways, Alaska, American, and United. With these programs, you can book one-way awards at half the price of a round-trip ticket, so that's a really good deal.
Yeah, let's take a second to dig a little deeper on why this can be useful. So for the location-independent types out there, the most obvious answer to that is that you might not know what's next after the first leg of your trip. maybe after Europe, you're undecided between onward travel to Asia or the Middle East. So that's one reason.
Yeah. The second reason is it's more practical, is sometimes the flights you need your return trip for aren't available to be booked with miles right now. So, or maybe the only seat left is in the wrong class and it violates the booking rules or jacks up the price of the ticket.
The bottom line here is that one-way awards offer tons of extra flexibility. So stay tuned for an avalanche of advice on how to book that like a pro. Next up, we're going to talk about open jaws. This means you get to fly into one city and fly home from another. Can be a huge advantage if you plan to move around a bit on your trip, and it isn't really convenient for you to have to retrace your steps back to get the flight home.
For example, you might fly from the U.S. to Paris, then use Eurorail to check out a bunch of countries on the way to Greece. If your airline allows an open jaw, you could fly home from Athens instead of Paris.
Open jaws are a great reason to diversify your points holdings. If you booked the trip AJ just mentioned, you'd still have to get from Paris to Athens. If you have some fixed value points, like, say, Capital One Rewards or Barclays Arrival points, you can use those to get cash back when you book your Eurorail ticket or travel hack that part of your trip as well.
Yeah. Now, the last big routing rule is the stopover award. Stopovers can turn a simple trip into a multi-stop around-the-world trip. There are several airline programs that let you book ridiculous itineraries that bounce from Western to Eastern Europe to the Middle East and Asia.
Pulling off one of these types of trips with multiple stops does require some advanced knowledge, but the stopover itself can be quite simple. Delta, United, American, and U.S. Airways all allow some type of stopover, but the rules are different for each program. In episode 8, we're going to take you on a deep dive into the routing and booking rules we just talked about today. For now, it's time to move on to the last module of redemption.
Okay, so airline alliances and partnerships, it's like having Magic Johnson on your frequent flyer basketball team, just the versatile man, 6'10", running point, dunking on people, shooting, dishing,
awesome, man.
Dishing dimes.
For those of you guys who don't know, Magic's number 5 on the all-time NBA assist leaderboard, and that's a great analogy for how airline partnerships work. If the program you have miles with doesn't fly where you want to go, they can get an assist from one of their partner airlines that flies that route.
So just to reiterate, you have to follow the United program rules to book with United Miles, but you can actually fly on more than 24 partner airlines.
When you include the routes operated by partner airlines, your possible destinations and the inventory of bookable award seats increase exponentially. Sure, United flies to Europe, but if they're out of business class seats, you can grab one on a partner airline, which, by the way, are almost definitely going to be better, nicer business class products than United has anyways.
Yeah, there are three major airline alliance is called SkyTeam, Star Alliance, and Oneworld. In general, you can use points from any airline to get a seat on a flight operated by one of their alliance partners. Airlines that aren't part of one alliance may have direct partnerships with other airlines. Advanced hackers use alliances and partnerships to work their way around inconvenient rules or unnecessary expenses.
They can also be helpful if you know you want to take advantage of a specific award chart or program rule, but the airline doesn't fly where you want to travel. In other words, you accumulate points in the program with the rules you like and book on a partner who flies where you want. I think that's probably a good place to leave it for today. Next week, we're going to be going the distance like Steve Prefontaine talking about
sports
pricing and award charts. Mr. Dunn, what's been coming out of your headphones lately, man? I need an eye jowl.
Oh, man, I can bring it for you. So it's a French duo called Cliande. The song we're going to bring to you is called Jubel. It actually means cheers or jubilance in Swedish. It was released in September 2013 as a single, and it's reached number one in Austria, Belgium, Germany, Switzerland, and Italy. So it hasn't quite come to the States, so that's why we're excited to bring it to you. So now we're going to play you out with Jubel by Cliande.
See you guys next week. Hey, Abroaders, don't be shy. The best part of our day is connecting with you. Send your show feedback, comments, or questions to Erik or AJ at Abroaders.com. You can also leave us an audio note right on the website and maybe even get yourself featured on the next episode of the Abroaders podcast. Oh, 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 oh